Well, good morning, everybody. It is Sunday, April 25th. This month is almost gone. Jesus. I am off to an early start here. It is a little past 7:30 in the morning. Been up for a while because today we're doing a photo shoot with the immediate family. And it's going to be all day. We're shooting a whole bunch of publicity and promo and whole a lot of different things. I got a suitcase behind me with a whole bunch of different black t-shirts in it for costume changes. Just, yeah. But that's going to be great. It's going to be great to see the guys, and this will be a real productive day. And then I'm going to get home and watch the Academy Awards, the Oscars. And mainly the thing I'm rooting for on that is, boy, I hope Diane Warren wins for her song this year. Laura Pausini, I believe, is going to be singing it with her, and who's amazing. I did work with her, and I've posted a video about Laura in the past, but this is the 12th nomination for Diane, who's one of the most prolific songwriters of our generation and has won every other award there is, and beyond the fact that she's sold millions and millions and millions of records, this has been the elusive one for her, is the Academy Awards. So, man, the music community in town here is all rooting big time for Diane. So let's hope for the best. I thought everybody seems to really enjoy getting turned on to new artists, and not necessarily new artists, but artists they haven't known about in the past. And so today, I've got a very dear friend who's up in the Idaho area, and he's been there for a long time, and he's a staple of the music community in that area of the country, kind of in the way Livingston Taylor is in New England and stuff. I mean, Steve has his major following, and he's been working for decades up there, and he's a wonderful singer-songwriter. And the thing that's cool about this is... the album I'm going to play you some of the songs from, we recorded in 1974, yet about 4 months ago or so, I just finished doing a new album with him too. So this is a prolific artist who's still completely at it and really writing great songs. The new album is really good, far more. It's got funk and R&B in it and stuff and some jazz. I mean, he's really great, but this was during the great period of singer-songwriter kind of folk music of James Taylor Jackson, everybody of that ilk in 74. And his name is Steve Eaton, E-A-T-O-N. So this is an album we did called Hey, Mr. Dreamer. And this is from, like I said, 1974. Steve's family is amazing too. His son Marcus Eaton is a wonderful artist who I've worked with, really talented, and his son AJ is really talented. I mean, I've known these men now. I've known them since they were born. I remember giving them, you know, sending them baby presents when they were born and stuff. So it's pretty mind blowing. I mean, this is the thing that really gets to you after a while, is you kind of judge your age. Because when you're with your contemporaries, generally, about the only thing that's really changed is white hair or less hair, and or weight, and that's kind of where it seems to go. But when you see the baby that you knew, and they're introducing you to their kids and stuff, that's when you go, wow, time has marched on. But Steve's really good, and I really love this new album. I can't wait to get him to send me a copy of it, and I'll turn you onto it, because we did another album after the one I'm playing this for, and one of my favorite songs is on that, and it maybe at some point I'll play that one for you. It's called Raking Leaves in the Wind, and it lyrically, it is just great, and just the imagery that it poses, you know, kind of equating life to being out there raking leaves in the wind is really exquisite. You know what that means, copious notes. Not so many on this one, though, but the band on this album was myself, Steve playing acoustic guitar and vocals, both splitting drum duties was David Kemper and Jim Gordon. The guitars on this were Dean Parks and Mike Dacey. Richard Bennett playing steel. And the thing that's amazing is, I mean, so this is 74. I mean, I've done so many records with Dean Parks over the years. Mike Dacey, when I was in the group Therapy in 1967, and we were not allowed to play on our record. It was the Wrecking Crew who played on our record. Mike Post produced us. Well, Mike Dacey and I believe Dennis Budimir and Al Casey were the three guitarists on our album. Richard Bennett, I've worked with for many, many years, and the last time I saw him, I believe he's in Mark Knopfler's band, but we did a lot of stuff. He moved down to Nashville. On keyboards, it doesn't get much better than this. We have Larry Nechtel, Mike Melvoin, and Michael O'Mardian on this. And, you know, these guys were just staples of the studio scene. An incredible horn section of Chuck Finley, Jim Horn, Tom Scott, Dick Slidehide, Paul Hubenon, and Snooky Young. So that's an incredible horn section. And Jay Center produced it. I believe it was Jay who produced I Am Woman, because a lot of this is a bunch of the same cats. And the background vocals on this were Cindy Bullins and the Dirt Sisters. But this is Steve Eaton, and I just figured this was some pretty sweet stuff for early Sunday morning. And then I'm going to get my stuff loaded up. I've got a bunch of instruments I'm taking for different, you know, possibilities in pictures, and we'll see. So this one is called Railway to Heaven. So here we go. Steve Eaton, 1974. Peace, love, bass on this one.
Trains and buses can
take you right
here. Where you want to go. But there ain't no railway to heaven. There ain't no jet plane to take me there.
Thank you. I mean, it really defines that period too, of just these storytelling songwriters. It's pretty cool. The new stuff we did was much edgier. I was really blown away by what he's doing now. And when I get some, I'll go ahead and present that to you. But I love this period. All these great songwriters that came out of it, singers, artists. And generally, we always had a very similar group, cast of characters on the album. So there was a really cohesive quality to it. And the thing that was beautiful during that period was generally, it was one team that made the whole record. It's not like I've talked about before in this day and age where you're not even talking records for the most part, but when people are doing projects, sometimes you go take a look at it and there's like eight producers on it and 12 songwriters and, you know, all this stuff. And you kind of go, I mean, each track has its own unique personality, but I'm of the school. I really love to hear a project where it has a cohesive, unifying quality to it. And that was, this period was like that. And we would hunker down in the studio and do all the tracks. And then they would, you know, figure out order and spacing between things and mastering and all that. But the band itself was really there for the whole thing. So here's another one. This is called We're All Powered by the Same Old Juice. Yeah, let's see what we got with this one. Oh, stop sending messages. Jesus.
Walking down the street in the poor side of town with a tap on my shoulder, and I looked around and see the eyes of the poor man staring me in my face. I looked at him and I smiled and said, "Lizard man, do you need some bread?" He just laughed at me and said, "No, but let's talk a while." He told me who he was and where he'd been, and all about this crazy world we're living in. To think bad of him for the way he looked. Then he reached in his pocket and he pulled out a song and said these were some words he'd been working on. And this was the way that he'd seen it through his eyes.
We're all powered by the same old juice, and by working together we can turn it loose on a world that's helpless and very much in. It was a chance just to sing a song, and the old man's life had not been lived in vain.
We're all
burned
by the same old juice, and by working together we can turn it loose on a world that's helpless and very much in need.
Hey, hey, hey,
hey. We're all burned by the same old juice, and by working together we can turn it loose on a world that's helpless and very much in.
Yeah.
quickie fade there. Yeah, I'm just hearing all these people playing. Yeah, it was so much fun being in the studio with these musicians. Larry Nechtel and Mel Voyne were part of the Wrecking Crew, and Nechtel, beyond, like, he was the pianist on Bridge Over Troubled Water, but he was the bass player on Hey Mr. Tambourine Man. I used to love Larry. He would sit at the piano, and he sat kind of side saddle on the bench, hardly ever touched the pedals on it. And he ended up moving up to, I think, Northern Washington, had a studio at his house up there. And I flew up there with some other guys, and we did Barry McGuire's album up there. And it was so much fun just being up in that part of the country with him. Larry was really quite a special guy. And Mike Melvoin was just one of the greatest pianists on the studio scene, because he did everything from like the super legit stuff to just fun, crazy stuff. And his daughter and Gary Coleman's daughter were Wendy and Lisa in Prince's Revolution. So the families also moved on. But Mike was, he and Hal Blaine were probably two of the best storytellers. We'd be dying in the studio all the time, just laughing with these guys, because they knew how to tell a joke and a story. It was really something. And Omardian was one of the more gifted people. I had an opportunity to work with him a few times after he moved to Nashville. I would do projects there, but we worked a great deal in Los Angeles when he lived here. And, you know, I'm just looking over this cast of characters is just, it's pretty something. I mean, I went to college with Tom Scott and Jim Horn. I did so many sessions with him and Chuck Finley. God, these guys are just, they were a part of my DNA. You know, David Kemper and I did a lot of things. He's a wonderful drummer. And Jim Gordon, needless to say, was just one of the, you know, Mad Dogs and Englishmen and all that. And I worked with so many albums with him. So it's really fun when I listen to these, and it kind of takes me back to all these guys who I cut my teeth with, right along with them. We were all in this kind of, you know, having daily adventures together, you know, figuring this whole thing out. This one is the title track to the album. This is called Hey Mr. Dreamer. But if you want, Steve has a bunch of stuff on YouTube, and he's really, really talented guy. And it's interesting when you kind of follow some of these things, and you can see people's evolution as artists throughout the years. And I can hardly wait to play some of his new stuff, because I was, like I said, I was really blown away when he sent me the tracks to put bass on. And I went over and I did a couple of my bass parts I did over with John Gilliton, who then got involved, and I think John worked on the album too, who's just a great keyboard player and a dear friend, and just killed me the other day. He stopped by my house. He's gotten into baking, and he brought over this big steaming loaf of bread he had made that was unbelievable, you know, fresh out of the oven, wrapped in a towel. And took me a day and a few hours to eat this whole thing, and just sitting here with butter slathering away on it going, well, I think I could skip all the rest of my meals. I'm just going to eat John's loaf of bread. So that was great the last couple of days. So, okay, I digress. Here's Hey Mr. Dreamer. Bass started.
When I was a boy, I had a dream. A dream much bigger than the sky. Having a mind of my own. I packed my bags and I bid my folks goodbye. I got together with some friends from my hometown. Started a band and we did some traveling around. Playing the music folks just love to hear. For a song and dance and a belly of glass of beer. Yeah, Mr. Dreamer, what you've been up to. I said, oh, nothing but the same old thing. Playing my music, chasing my dream. I said, don't you think it's time that you're settling down? I said, maybe I will next time around. It all depends if my record's number one. But until then, I guess I've just begun. But hey, Mr. Dreamer, dream on. Chasing your dream, singing a song. Hey, chaser dreams doesn't realize what he's got. I've got it, make believe it or not. Playing the music folks just love to hear. For a song and dance and another glass of beer.
Nice long fade. You never know. I'll do one more song and then I've got to get loaded up and ready to, not loaded up, I'm going to go show up hammered or anything like that. Just get the rest of my stuff together and put it in my truck and hit the highway. It should be, it's a long drive up there. It's a good hour drive to where I'm headed, but hopefully on a Sunday morning there won't be anything crazy. There's so many times in town here where you go, oh man, it's like I got off work at 2 a.m. It's going to be just great, an easy drive home and all. And then Caltrans is out there and they've closed three of the freeway lanes down and it's like worse than rush hour, you know, at 2 in the morning. So, you know, fingers are crossed that we'll get through, get out there okay and stuff. So here's one last little tune here. This is called Something About Her.
And the rain fell down.
Well, as I looked through credits, I did not find anything for string arrangements or who the string section was on this. A lot of these dates that we did back in those days, Sid Sharp was the concert master on them, so it could have been him, but I didn't see anything, so I feel sorry about not being able to give a shout out to the string section on that's beautiful stuff. But that was just kind of this fabulous golden age of singer-songwriters, you know, and certainly James Taylor really was the one who really paved the way into this new world of singer-songwriters. And I was just very, very fortunate to be in the right place at the right time to meet him and end up with the career that I ended up with, mainly because of those associations. And I love the fact that, you know, I just saw Steve a while back and got to work on the new stuff, like I said. And check out his son, Marcus Eaton. Also, he's really good. He did a bunch of work with David Crosby when we worked on the album Cross. Marcus is on that, and he's done great solo stuff. He's really a great guy to see live because he does a lot of stuff with looping and stuff where he creates like a full orchestra on stage, but he's really something too. So I'm going to get going here now and get off on this thing. It's 8 o'clock now, a few minutes after 8, and I should be on the road in a little while to get started. We got an early call to get started on these photographs. So take good care. Have a great Sunday. I wish you all the very best. I'll be back tomorrow. And tomorrow's going to be actually cool. There's a fella coming over in the afternoon tomorrow, and I'm going to be being filmed for a fundraising charity. Sheldon Dingwall has donated a bass, and those are my go-to five-string basses are Dingwall. So they sent me one to sign and then shoot a little video of it, and then it's going to go up for sale for charity. So I'm looking forward to that. And then Tuesday will be the live stream, so that'll be fun. And there's a bunch of different things going on. So I wish you a great Sunday. Stay safe. That's all I can ever emphasize right now. The most important thing is staying safe, staying alive, and not in a BG sense, but in a humanity sense. And again, every day I have to thank them, all the workers that are putting themselves in harm's way every day. Things are getting better, but they're not right yet. So these people, you know, don't get the weekends off and things, especially in healthcare and things like that. It's tough. I appreciate them so much. So you take good care, and I will see everybody tomorrow. I'm off to try to look pretty for a photo shoot. So wish me luck. I'll see you tomorrow. Okay, bye-bye.